Hello there, I'm Blackbright, broadcasting out of the UK. Welcome to my channel. And if you want to subscribe, please do so. Or you can click the like button or the down button, whatever you feel free doing. You can interact with my subscribers, but please do so respectfully. Remember that this is a respectful platform, so we don't want any kind of offensive communications, because when they're reported to me, I then have to block the user or the subscriber, and then just to make other people feel free to talk how they wish to talk in a respectful way. Now, today I wanted to talk about the passports, which are coming out, being rolled out mid-June, well, mid-2020. So I'm assuming that's June 2020. It's the first time we're changing passports since 1988, when the burgundy ones came out. And now we have the blue. So now we've got the red, we'll call it red, burgundy's from the red family. We've got the blue. I wonder why we haven't got a white, so we can have red, white and blue. Or indeed, why haven't they done a red, white and blue passport to reinforce sovereignty? That would make it quite interesting, wouldn't it? And it would give the passports a specific identity if they were red, white and blue. Anyway, there's reasons for changing the colours, is there? Reasons for upgrading the technology and the security features, is there? Or are we being distracted by the real reason why passports need to change? Yes, we're leaving the EU. And this is, well, I guess it's a way of reclaiming a British identity by producing a brand new passport. But guess what? Now, you would think that if the British want to retain their sovereignty and keep Britain British and keep Britain white or whatever, they would have these passports produced in England. You would think that the 270 million that they're paying out to produce them would be kept in England so that British workers could benefit. But oh no, they're outsourcing them to Poland, which is in the EU. And we have a French company who's got the contract. How ironic, you're leaving the EU, yet you're still paying countries in the EU to produce your British passport. Now, why Poland? Well, people might be laughing and saying, oh, they're going outside the EU, they're going to the EU and having their passports produced by EU country. Why are they doing it with Poland? Well, Poland rebelled against the EU. So the UK isn't really being disloyal. The far right party, PIS, that's in Poland, they have rebelled against the EU, and the EU are stuck with them because they couldn't get a unanimous vote because Hungary wanted to protect Poland. So Poland are reaping the benefits of EU membership, but they're not obeying the law. So therefore, by Britain using Poland to produce their passports, they're not really being disloyal because Poland has rebelled against the EU also. So where am I going with this? I don't even know. All I know is that we're being issued with new passports, and I just have a funny feeling that it's got more to do with the colour of the passport, the security features, and more to do with the wording within the passport. Now, oh, I wanted to bring my black passport and show you. Not to worry. Now, I had one of the black passports, and that was then changed to the burgundy passports. And the wording within the black passport was totally different to the wording in the blue passport. I'm inclined to go and get it, but I'll see how I go. Well, it was not totally different, but a bit different to the wording in the blue passports, in the burgundy passports. So I've got a funny feeling that anybody who gets a blue passport, I mean, they're not going to be able to match it with one of the older passports because they probably wouldn't have one. And by the time I get a new passport, I'll probably be dead. Got to wait another, I think I've got to wait another 8 years for a new passport. But it'd be very interesting if you do keep your Burgundy passport. I think they return it to you with a clip on the end to see how the wording has changed and to let me know how the wording has changed, if the wording has changed. I've got a funny feeling that the wording in the new blue passports will change to reflect changes in immigration and changes reflecting imminent, well, changes to reflect imminent changes to legislation. I've got a funny feeling that there'll be more concrete ways of reducing immigrants from coming into the country. I think there'll be more clued up in the language of how to prevent people becoming citizens, you know, naturalized citizens. I've got a funny feeling that the wording and the customization of the new passports will have more to do with the color and the technology of them. But that's just my opinion. Who am I? I have no idea. I'm just speculating because it's a lot of expense to go through just to change the color and just to upgrade it with a few extra security features when the ones we have now are really quite advanced. But apparently the new ones are going to be economically friendly and the most highly high-tech passports ever made, apparently. Anyway, what have I got written here? I've got more or less what I've said, actually. Excellent opportunity to reflect all the immigration changes to legislation. Reinforce the fluidity of citizenships of foreign nationals. Perpetuate the exclusion of immigrants in the new passports. UK is forever amending legislation. So what better way to customise passports to what the UK wants it to reflect? It's being produced in Poland via French contractors who get just under 300 million to produce them. I think it's between 270 million, something around there. We haven't been given no precise figures. It's only that the ones that were done by Gestalt before, that I think they paid them 216 million for the contract. And I would think that with inflation, it would go up. So I was kind of giving an estimated figure, but I really haven't got a clue how much the new contract is. Yeah, I was trying to, I also wrote, why give UK money to the EU who you're meant to be extricating yourself from to keep the UK impoverished so far as to start? Oh, yeah. What I was thinking is that, you know, by not keeping the money in Britain, what are you doing to Britain? Are you impoverishing Britain? And, you know, with poverty, there always comes war. And is that what all this is about? To create so much discord, to raise issues about race. I mean, EU, they're not even talking about its progressive social political policies. It's just become a platform for racial divide and to, you know, to talk about racial issues and about whether or not immigration is going to be less and how to reduce immigration and how to stop people coming in. Is that all EU stands for? I'm sure EU stands for a lot more. People were talking about, will we lose our human rights if we leave the EU? Well, to be honest, what did I write here? European Court of Human Rights was established in 1950 by all the countries in Europe, both in the social bloc and those in the West. They then competed on who could incorporate human rights the best in their policies. The social bloc, from my perspective, were probably more sincere in their efforts to protect human rights, whereas the West were probably on an ego trip and just wanted to win. Enacting what they pledged was a different ball game. Because what is the legacy of the West with regard to human rights? It kind of fluctuates, doesn't it? What's written down on paper and what actually happens and whether you try to pursue any infringement on human rights, it's not met with any real support. So, you know, it's just lip service, really. The European Charter states that everyone has a right to work, but you find you need certain credentials to work. And while we have the right to work, there's also a lack of jobs. So I'm talking about human rights now. The European Charter says everyone has a right to seek work, but that depends on your circumstances, doesn't it? I don't think when the European Charter was talking about seeking work, it had any stipulations or conditions attached to it. But you're allowed to seek work as long as you're documented. Anybody undocumented cannot seek work, even if they have no criminal background. The European Charter also says everyone has a right to health services, but we are forced to pay for it. And if you are undocumented, you lose that right. Rights seem to come with conditions. Was that what the European Charter intended? The EU says everyone has a right to benefit from health services, but do we? They say only in emergency situations. Why? Because as an emergency, when you go in, it's a good way to extract your data and give it to the Home Office and find out whether or not you're legally in the country or not. That's the only reason. Otherwise, even if you had an emergency, like in America, they wouldn't see you or they'd send you to the poorhouse. We don't have the equivalent in the UK, so they make it look like they're doing you a favour by attending to you in emergency situation. But it's just a clever way to get all your information. So that's why, in part, I mean, yes, you get attended to if they deem you to be a real emergency. But even if they don't deem you to be a real emergency, they've already got all your information, all the information they need. All they've got to do is click, 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 match that up, inform the Home Office if there's something suspicious. And that's another tick against a box. You might even get a bill later, especially if you're illegal and you're not entitled to the service. Trump has just handed 7 million through the United Health Group to prioritise NHS patients into high, medium and low risk. I am sure that was not what the European Charter meant when they said everyone had a right to benefit from the health services. So now, who's going to be prioritised? Are the elderly going to be put at the bottom because they're deemed useless and worthless to society? They've done their part, so why should we operate on them? Why should we try to heal them? Why should we try to ease their pain and make them better? They're on their way out, so why should we bother? So will leaving the EU affect your human rights? I leave you to decide on that one. I ain't got a clue. What else have I got here? Why, when we are leaving the EU, why would the EU be responsible for a large part of producing the passports? Already said that. Customising. Yeah, even though they're going to be, the French have got a contract, they do have 500 employees in the UK who are going to be working on the passport. So yes, there will be some kind of UK benefit from it. I'm not sure if that's just to customize and manipulate the wording or whatever they do, but who's to know? We're not going to know, are we? Separating from the European Union as a bloc is no longer about being associated with progressive social democratic party policy, but an excuse to exploit racism and conduct talks and debates along racial lines. I've already said that, actually. Most of the arguments I hear, especially about question time, they're all devised to get the responses that they want. If somebody responds in a way that's not conducive to what they want to hear, they switch it or they speak over them. Because really what it's about is to make people feel as though they're stupid, number one. They try to word it. One thing about the British is that they're wordsmiths and they can turn their language in such a way to make you, who has raised their concerns, look unfair, biased, unjust, petty. I was watching one the other day, and it was like, so do you mean to say that you are saying that all these criminals should stay in the country? It was totally not what the person was saying, but they have a way of switching what you say, twisting it around, and then you end up thinking, is that really what I'm saying? That's what I'm saying. A lot of those politicians and a lot of those newscasts, they're very narcissistic. They know how to make you feel as though you're going crazy when you put forward questions and make you feel like an idiot when you're not one. The majority of people who feel it know you're not an idiot, but when you're on the big screen and when you are a minority, it doesn't carry much weight. What is that? Oh yeah, it's one of my appointments. I've silenced that. Some of my subs, okay. What else is that? I think I have covered most of what I wanted to say with regard to the passport. So, are we going to get a red, white and blue passport? Like I said, I don't see why not. There is another interesting point. I was talking about Poland and they're getting they're producing the passports, and people were asking why they're going out to Poland to produce the passport, which is a part of the EU. And it's a bit ironic, you're leaving the EU when you're getting your passports done by them. In 2017, PIS, which is Poland's right-wing political party, they came into power. They're authoritarians who rebelled against the EU and took back their independence from the EU. So the UK, by siding with Poland to do the passports, they know what they're doing. Poland and the UK are on the same page with regard to the EU. The EU invoked Article 7.1, which allows the EU to strip Poland, which should allow the EU to strip Poland of her voting rights, especially if they feel that a country is breaking the criteria established in 1993. And they tried that for the first time in history, but they were unsuccessful because Hungary protected, because Hungary wanted to protect Poland. So it couldn't go through. So that was the main thing I wanted to say about that. I think I've kind of gone over a couple of things twice. But yeah, I think I've kind of got it all out there, what I wanted to say about the passports. So you won't have to pay any extra for the blue passports. You'll get one when your current one expires. They've all got a 10-year life, so they're expecting everybody to have a new passport by 2030. At the moment, I think if you get it online, they're £75.50. If you do it by paper, it's £85. Goodness knows, in 10 years' time, it might be £100 or more to get a British passport. I probably won't be flying anywhere in 10 years' time, so I probably won't even get one. But I might just get one just to add it to my portfolio. I love the idea of that. I've actually got a history of it. It'd be nice to have the history of the three different types of passports. And yeah, so I think that is all for now. Bye-bye.